Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in 2017. I would ask everyone in the room to ensure their mobile phones are on silent. It's acceptable to use mobile devices, but for social media, but please don't take photographs or film proceedings. The first item on the agenda is our approach papers on two public petitions. First petition is P1628, consultation and service delivery for the elderly or vulnerable, and we're asked to consider the evidence presented and the petition and the evidence presented to the Public Petitions Committee in connection with the petition as part of its inquiry into the petition itself. So do the committee have any comments to make on the petition? Colin?
Thanks, convener. The only thing to say, I mean, there's obviously a lot of valid points in the petition itself, but given the fact we're obviously starting a piece of work today on engagement between IGBs and stakeholders, could I suggest that we simply incorporate the issue into that session today and dismiss the petition, but actually cover the issues during the course of the discussion today?
Okay. Anyone else? Donald?
Yep. I should say I visited the care home in question in Dunoon, and I have a particular wish to see. I don't mind dismissing the petition as long as we consider the very important issues that it raises. Yeah. So I do have a particular local issues with it. Thank you.
Any other members wish to comment? Okay, is Colin's course of action agreed?
Yep.
Okay, thank you very much. The second petition is P1605, whistleblowing in the NHS. Again, we want to consider the evidence presented and open up to members for any comments. Alison?
I'd like to suggest that the committee incorporate and consider this as part of our inquiry into NHS governance. I think that seems highly appropriate, and that perhaps we look at having a session on whistleblowing too as part of that inquiry.
Any other comments? Okay, we all agreed that we take that approach. I think that's a very sensible approach. Okay, thank you very much. Agenda item two, integration authorities' engagement with stakeholders. We have two evidence sessions today. The first is a panel session, and can I welcome to the committee Claire Cairns, coordinator of the Coalition of Carers in Scotland, representing national carer organisations; Heather Petrie, future and specialist delivery team leader, Voluntary Action South Lanarkshire; Linda McGlynn, regional engagement manager, Diabetes Scotland; and Sonia Cottom, director of the Pain Association Scotland. Thank you very much for coming along this morning. Who would like to ask the first question? Get us started, Alex.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for coming to see us today. I wonder if you could start by giving us an overview of the landscape of how integrated joint boards communicate and engage with stakeholders in the current climate.
Our submission was very much based on the experience of carer reps on IJBs. We've actually been running a project since May last year, bringing together the carer reps from across Scotland. So they've had four meetings altogether, and that's been about them sharing their experience and learning from each other, and also looking at some of the challenges and the best practice in terms of their representative role. So I would say, in general, their experience has been mixed across Scotland. At the initial meeting in Edinburgh, there was a degree of frustration that they were feeling, perhaps that they were unsure of their role, a lot of them feeling quite isolated. And I think a lot of the frustration was around the way that meetings were conducted. But in saying that, as the meetings have progressed, we have seen a lot of improvements and best practice development. And so when we came to write the scoping report, which I think you've got copies of, the experience had changed quite a lot within that time period. In saying that, the care reps share a lot of similar challenges across Scotland. And some of the things would include recruitment and induction, which quite often happened later on in the process. It didn't happen before they joined the boards. It happened perhaps later on. But a lot of them have received training now and have met with key people and so on, and so are feeling more that they've been given the support in order to fully participate. There are some variations around the support and resources that carers receive in their role. So, for example, with carers, we would hope that they would get all their transport costs, but also replacement care costs reimbursed, and that's not necessarily always the case. Some carers use, for example, their own direct payments when they're attending meetings, and that does reduce the short breaks that they get for themselves. So I think that could be looked at. And one of the key things is being representative. So in terms of being a carer on an IJB, it needs to be beyond just that individual person's experience, because caring comes in many different shapes and forms. And so work works well. They've got a community of other carers that they're referring to and going back to, and there's good communication between the two. And that happens actually in a lot of areas. Very often they connect to carer forums or their local carer centre and other carer groups, which means that when they go along to the IJB meetings, they've already had conversations with a variety of local carers. But there are some difficulties around that. Quite often the timing of the meetings, for example, or the papers coming out late mean that they can't get those conversations before they attend the groups. I said before, there are some frustrations around meetings, like the amount of paper, that when you get the paper, sometimes it's only 24 hours in advance, them being quite high level and the idea that you can't contribute because it is decisions which are just being rubber stamped at the meeting. Not as much discussion as people would like. So there are, again, areas where there could be improvement in terms of how the meetings are conducted. And then we would say the ultimate test would be, have they made a difference? We did some scoping around that, which we could probably move on to, but I would say initially it was difficult for carers to make a difference, but we are seeing more progress in that area as well. So some really good practice across Scotland, but again, some challenges that need addressed.
Anyone else wish to comment?
And from a Deputy Scotland perspective, we've found involving with the IGBs at a strategic level and at a locality level to be somewhat challenging. We have a network of about 40 local groups, and a lot of the local groups found that they weren't accessing the information. Several of the local groups had been involved in local patient involvement forums, so they were aware of the processes, but many of the other groups were not aware of how to engage with the IGBs or the locality plans. Those that did engage found that they couldn't really see where they'd had a significant impact. If they had made suggestions, there was no feedback to say, you said this, but we didn't go for that because of X, Y, and Z. So it was fairly challenging. From a national level, we certainly found it challenging in terms of, we did significant desktop research to find out where the strategic plans were, what were the priorities, where diabetes sat with that, how it sat within the long-term conditions. And we found it extremely challenging. So we did write to every single IGB and every single senior manager to extend an invitation to meet with us to see how we could support the IGBs. Sadly to say that several of those organisations failed to even respond and acknowledge the letter. So we did the information and freedom requests, and we found a mixture of information that came from that. IGBs were saying one thing about devolved diabetes services, and the health board was saying something completely different. So we just found that the communication channels were a bit abstract and opaque. And obviously we welcome the IGBs. We think they're a good opportunity to improve diabetes services and person-centred care. And we would welcome co-production rather than just a tick box exercise.
Heather?
In South Lanarkshire, my CEO sits on the integration board along with a service user rep and a carer rep. Our CEO meets with these individuals to discuss the papers. That's quite a recent thing to make sure that the information's passed forward. We've also set up third sector forums in each of the localities. We've got four in South Lanarkshire, and that is chaired by a third sector organisation who sits on the locality boards as well, as I'm a representative from the third sector interface. So we've got that information that we can then pass back. In South Lanarkshire, we're talking about, just for community groups, and organisations, we're talking about 1,600 that we know of. So we couldn't expect that all of those 1,600 groups could sit round the table. So we see the third sector interface as being the conduit in passing out that information.
Sonia, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I would echo a lot of what Linda was saying in terms of it's been, for ourselves, it's been quite challenging. And operating through with the majority of health boards throughout Scotland. For ourselves, actually, it's been quite impractical as well to be aware of the way in which a lot of the IAs are developing the services. And it's been challenging as well to try and find out who are the key personalities around the table who we need to be liaising with, especially the people that we've dealt with, for example, within health boards, in terms of negotiating service level agreements. You know, we kind of found out by default that they had moved on and had no way of knowing who we were supposed to be dealing with. So again, you're trying to kind of find out all that information, trying to be involved and trying to comment on strategic plans, which are quite a first size and, really quite difficult.
Thank you very much for that. I'm very interested in this this tension that exists between the idea of consultation and the reality of co-production, as I think Linda identified. I think that a lot of organisations, and right back through time, when they believe they've got somebody at the table who speaks for a sector or a group, they kind of tick that box and forget about it or move on to other things. And sometimes that can represent a bottleneck, as we know there are many, many, many stakeholders in this field, and many of whom may not know what their interface is with the IJB. I just wonder if the panel, particularly from the IJB side of things, could reflect on what we are doing to broaden the net in terms of getting the opinions of other stakeholders or getting a route for those other stakeholders who don't potentially have a relationship with or even may have a toxic relationship with the reps who are on the IJBs through social media, through other events, that kind of thing.
I think where it works well in terms of the carers movement, and in some ways it is, I think we have better networks than some of the other stakeholders, but where it works well, you will have the carer on the IJB, as mentioned, who will then connect with their local carer forum. You also, I suppose, need to populate the other strategy groups and localities with carers as well, and somehow ensure that all these people communicate, so they're looking at working towards the same aims and goals. And that's quite challenging. Some areas are much further ahead than others. If there are resources put in to support those networks, and sometimes you might have, for example, in Perth, there is a post holder who is attached to the third sector forum and also the carer centre there, who provides support to the carer reps and the service user reps. So they have a meeting before they go into the IJB, they discuss items on the agenda and make sure that they've got all the information they need, and they ensure that they've got any training or mentoring that they need as well. And then they communicate with the carers voice group in Perth, which extends, like I say, the number of carers who are involved. But I think as well as that, you need another level down too. So that would be typically carers who are interested in policy and legislation, maybe have some experience in the area and want to contribute. It doesn't necessarily involve carers who are just getting on with caring and have other responsibilities in their life. They may work, they may have children, they've got lots of things going on. Realistically, they're not going to really want to get as involved in something like the development of policy or strategy locally, but it's something which really affects their lives. And I think the best way to connect with them is again through their natural communities. So, people from the IJBs actually attending carer groups that they go to or getting involved in social media, because carers who maybe don't attend physically groups, they very often are online as well and getting support that way. So it's not always about the carers going to the meetings. It's very much about the IJB and the integrated authority going to the places where they congregate or where they communicate as well.
If I may, one final question, convener. We've had a number of sessions with the Scottish Health Council around this table, who are ostensibly the forum for the voice of patients in the health service, and whether or not they do that effectively is a discussion for another day. But it strikes me they are well resourced, and they have potential a potentially quite a large reach. And does the panel think that perhaps, you know, we should look to perhaps expanding the remit of the SHC to be the Scottish Health and Social Care Council in these days of integration to better facilitate the voice of stakeholders in the design around integration?
Whether that's the model I would be going down from a diabetes perspective. I think it's more about ensuring that there's engagement channels up from the local networks of certainly from our groups. We have individuals that work at a local level as well as the local groups. And it's about that knowing who to contact and who to speak to and how they would then transfer that message up over. So it would work for some people, for not for everyone. So it's about, I suppose, a menu of communications from using social media, which we do use an awful lot with our young people, to actual local groups. So I think you can't just say it's one mechanism and one organisation. What we have found with the third sector interface is that across up and down Scotland, they don't always operate in the same way, so it's difficult to know who to get into to the third sector interfaces as well. So I think it's about recognising that some people will be quite easily and happily go to local meetings and localities. Some people, because of the demands on their condition, aren't able to do that. But we need to give them the mechanisms to be able to communicate up over, and also the mechanisms to actually feedback, because what is sadly lacking at the moment is that feedback mechanism to let people know that they've had an impact.
Could I ask what should happen then?
I think currently the model that we have in South Lanarkshire, we've recently got a new leader under health and social care. She puts out a regular blog, and we make sure that that goes out to all social media channels. It's through our newsletters and everything else, and she's always asking for feedback, so anybody in the community can actually come back and ask a question, and she's more than willing to sit down and go through it. It needs to be more open channels. You know, as part of our remit under the third sector with the third sector forums, all the locality managers are also coming to the third sector forums so that they can sit down with the third sector. It's just opening those channels.
What else should happen? I mean, is that what I'm really mean is, do you agree with that approach, or in other areas is there a different approach? And if there should be taken, and if there is, what is it?
I think, as I was kind of mentioning before, there's some really good practice out there already. It's just making sure that it's more consistent across Scotland. And in terms of supporting that, I think most of the support, wherever possible, should be local rather than national. There is a small role for national as well. I mean, for example, we do have our Carers Collaborative, which allows the carer reps to meet together 4 times a year. And I think that's been really beneficial for them in terms of previously feeling isolated and not being too sure of their role. But I would imagine that group shouldn't last forever, because they should be able to more develop their supports locally. I think that's better in the long term, but it's been good initially as these things have developed. But like I say, where they have good support and good links locally, that's where it works well. We've certainly, through the Carers Collaborative, produced a set of recommendations in terms of improving the experience of carers on IJBs. And a lot of that is around building those lines of communication, making sure there is support, making sure they're representative, and that is supported as well. And I think some of it is about putting some resources in that direction. One of the other challenges there is increasingly is trying to populate the many groups. So the localities, for example, as they develop, they're looking for carers to populate them as well. And it can be quite a bit of strain on carers if there's only one or two in the area who are taking on all of those roles. So again, there needs to be resources putting in to identify, supporting, training and recruiting additional carers to take on those roles. Some areas are doing that already, and like I say, quite often it works well when it sits in a hub like a carer centre and they're able to take information backward and forward, and there's somebody there whose role it is to do that. Where it's done on a more ad hoc basis, that's when the communication lines don't work as well. So I'll not go through the list of recommendations, but they are in the report that we have put forward, and I've got copies here as well if people are wanting them.
Any other suggestions from the panel as to how we can improve the situation?
I concur with what Claire said. I think we have to look at what's happening locally, what the demands are, and putting resources in. I think what we need to realise is a lot of the people, certainly people with diabetes, the condition is quite relentless. They can't always commit to regular inputs and meetings. The meetings are quite stressful in some instances. I think what we need is the resources at a local level. From a Diabetes Scotland perspective, we do support our local volunteers to get involved. We actually provide them with training. We provide them with expenses, out-of-pocket expenses. So there is a little bit around where there's a third sector organisation. We can work with the integration to support the local volunteers to get that two-way communication.
Do the boards have identified people who have responsibility for engagement? Is there a engagement officer or someone whose, you know, duties within the organisation is to engage with yourselves and others?
Certainly NHS Greater Glasgow has an involvement team and they do public involvement across the whole piece for NHS, for the boards. So there is a model there that works. There are community development officers out there within local authorities. So it's about how do they do that engagement. Community development is a good model. So it's about putting the local resources there from the IGB and working in partnership with the third sector organisations.
Okay. Alison?
Yes, thank you all for being here this morning and for the written submissions. The Pain Association's written submission, I think it's very frank. You sort of refer to the fact that, you know, engaging with some of this process is frankly a mystery. That you found it extremely difficult to find out within each integration authority who's responsible for commissioning. I mean, it sounds as if it's just making, and you speak about it simply being another layer of bureaucracy that's making it very difficult for you to deliver your services. And you also speak about 3-year service level agreements, you know, the challenge of that being reduced to 1 year. I just wondered if things have improved at all, if you've managed to find out who it is you need to be speaking to or to develop any of those important relationships yet.
As of yet, no, we've not seen any improvements. The one step forward we have made, simply because we requested a meeting with a representative from the Alliance, because we were finding the whole thing such a mystery as to who we would contact and who these people are, we asked, can we have a meeting? Can we have any support and guidance as to who we're supposed to be approaching, you know, within each authority? Who is responsible for this? Because despite writing to the health boards and saying, you know, I'm actually going to people on the ground, sort of clinicians, to say, do you know within your board who is responsible, so that we can approach them to, you know, show them the value of the service, say, this is how we deliver, can this service continue, and can we provide this and have this continuity of service for patients? So, yeah, that has been our challenge.
And you're not convinced yet that there's a solution there?
No.
That there's adequate
signposting? No, I'm based on sort of an experience with a particular board where we have come across them approaching us to say, well, come along to a meeting to negotiate your service level agreement. You know, we were invited along only to be told, well, these are the new personalities dealing with it, tell us about your service, but we don't actually see the value of self-management in terms of, we don't see the value of people representing every month to maintain self-management skills. It's about, it should be a one-stop shop, get them in, get them out the door. That's not what it's about, self-management. Mm-hmm. So again, we're back to square one, trying to put that case forward and convince. So I don't see that as an improvement and a step forward.
I
think at the moment there's still quite a lot of fluctuation and change in terms of staff on IJBs and the integrated authorities as a whole. So it is very difficult for people to pin down who the best person is to speak to. And then very often when they do, they've moved on or something's happened. I know, for example, one integrated authority, the care rep, was telling us that in terms even of the development of localities, it's kind of come to a bit of a standstill because of the change in staff in the IJB. The key chief officers have left, they're recruiting new ones. There'll be changes after the local council election. So it's in a bit of flux at the moment. And for example, we asked our care reps at the last meeting, did they know the care leads in their local area? And a lot of them didn't know there were care leads. And that would be really the primary person they would want to connect in with in their local area, who maybe would be responsible for the local carers strategy, the Carers Act coming in. So I think there is a bit of confusion. I think as well, feedback we're getting is in terms of the meetings, and because things are being established, an awful lot of time is taken up talking about staff issues and sort of in terms of administration, the organisations as a whole, and also then particular topics will come up again and again, like delayed discharge. So one carer told us that really took up the majority of several of the meetings. So amongst all that, I think it is difficult to get some of the things discussed which actually are more relevant to service users and carers, because other things have been given priority, or while things have been established, that hasn't really been discussed. It's happening more, I would say, now. There is being slow progress in that area. So after our first meeting of the IJB, we suggested that the carers reps try to table the Carers Act onto the agenda of the IJB. And we did it for a couple of reasons, just because we thought it was something that they should be discussing, you know, planning towards implementation at that level. But also we wanted to see how easy it would be for them to get something on the agenda. You know, were they able to place something on, and was it then taken up and did it follow through? And it has followed through in quite a number of areas. I can think of at least five where that's happened. Not all the care reps went ahead and tried to table it, so that's not across Scotland. But that has led to fruitful discussion. And then it's been something which has been a lot more relative, you know, relevant to the care reps, which has been helpful as well. But I would say that would be more unusual, and quite often businesses taken up with things which they don't always find relevant.
So in terms of the decision-making process, you were saying earlier about things just being a rubber stamp. Is there any debate and discussion? Is there any, for example, are you allowed to propose changes, amendments? Are you allowed to bring alternatives forward? Or is that just not within the scope of those sitting on at the meeting?
I don't think we're there yet. I mean, in our area, we did have an opportunity to get involved with the strategic commissioning, and third sector were very much involved in that, and we actually rated the items that were coming up. So out of the 10 thematic areas, 5 came from what we'd put forward, very much being like the preventative agenda. But I really don't think that we're there yet where we can actually turn around and make that big change, because at the moment it seems to be too much of the higher level stuff that they're dealing with.
At the last Carers Collaborative meeting, we kind of had a discussion around how you can put things on the agenda, something so fundamental in your local area. Some areas had an agenda committee and they were able just to submit and put an item on the agenda that way. And some had care reps on the agenda committee, or that was very unusual. Other people were able to put it under other items at the end of the agenda. Other people, even though they asked, there was just no mechanism for them to get something on the agenda, which meant that they really weren't equal partners. So I think that sometimes it's just the process, apart from anything else, which needs to be sorted out to make sure that carers can feel that they are equal partners around the table.
Colin?
Following up that point, convener, do you think that third sector organisations, carers representatives, should have voting rights on IJBs, or is it more a case of being able to influence policy before it gets to the stage of the IJB board actually deciding a paper?
I think what we found with where some of our representatives have been able to get to look at the strategic plans. Those strategic plans appear to have been rubber stamped before we've even really seen them and been asked to comment on them. So I think there's a mechanism about before you make the decisions, how do we influence those decisions and steer them? I think it needs to be a wee bit earlier on in the process.
We certainly wanted carers to have voting rights, and we kind of lobbied for that as the kind of act was going through Parliament. In terms of care reps themselves, we had discussions around that, and most of them would prefer to have voting rights, but a few actually have said that it frees them up more for discussion. That's probably a minority view, though, to be honest with you. But I would agree, actually, with what Linda said. It's really, by the time, not many things go to vote, and by the time it gets to vote, probably most of the decisions have been made already. Although we did have one example in one IJB where an issue went to vote, and if the stakeholders had been able to vote, the decision would have gone the other way. So that is one tangible example where they would have made a difference. But yes, it is very much about what happens before it gets to the IJB and making sure that things are co-produced rather than just carers are involved in consultation. So, for example, in one integrated authority, they were looking at reviewing their mental health services, and they came up with three options in terms of what they might put forward as solutions, but they only consulted on one, so they decided what the best option was, and then they consulted on that option. And there was a lot of anger, actually, from carers, and particularly the care reps and the IJB, because they felt they hadn't been part of that decision. I mean, it wasn't a full consultation when they were only being asked about the one option when they knew there'd been two others on the table. So I think when you come in at the end of a process, you don't own it. And also the solution might not necessarily be the best one either.
I would certainly go for the influence. I'm sure that you all know about the National Standards for Community Engagement. I don't know if necessarily all local authorities follow those standards.
Finish call?
Yeah. Up on that, do you think, looking at the nature of IJB meetings, do you think because you don't have voting rights, you're treated differently during the course of that meeting, or is the point is that most things don't actually go to a vote, so everybody does get their say?
I would say that we're slightly higher than just the tokenistic gesture, but I still think there is some ways to go on that. I don't know if the voting rights, you know, I think if we had more say, it might make a difference if there was true co-production. And maybe it comes down to the fact that I think if monies that were going to come into the third sector came to the third sector direct, that would give us more of an influence as for us to put that money back into the sector. And from that point of view, we would have more control and they might recognise us as a true partner if that was the case. But if I know that there was recommendations that went certainly about third sector interfaces involvement under health and social care, to me, because that was guidance, it wasn't necessarily followed. I know from our organisation that we had no investment under the third sector interface as regarding what we do in health and social care. So I really think that the money should actually go direct to the third sector and they would be then putting that money back in the pot, but they would be the ones that was influencing that decision and how that money was spent.
If I can just come in on that as well, I think it's important for the third sector to be part of the discussions before it gets to the voting rights, and especially if we follow up on the wish of the First Minister at her inaugural speech for health and social care integration in October 2015, when it was her wish and her vision to see the third sector as equal partners.
In terms of what's there now and what was there previously, is the system more democratic and can you influence it more or less than what was there previously?
Interestingly, previously with the CHCPs, carers did have voting rights, so that was a step back in terms of that. In terms of the ability to influence, I think it's hard to say, to be honest with you. I mean, I suppose the makeup of planning groups has changed. Probably a lot of the carers have remained the same. Some of them have come on from the CHCPs, and a lot of them are very experienced, very articulate people. And a lot of the personalities have changed. I would say it depends on the area. I don't know if there is significant difference to what happened before, but I think there's more opportunity now, and things are progressing. So I think in the future it will be an improvement, but we're just not there yet.
I would agree with that. I would say that we've still got a long way to go in terms of integration in the IGBs. I think it's an opportunity for us all to work together more positively and more appropriately. I think certainly from Diabetes Scotland point of view, although our sort of experience to date has been less than positive, we are making inroads, certainly at a local level. A lot of our local groups are making more inroads as they get the information and they get the communication. I think with all these processes, communication is the key. And we need to get better at that communication. If we get better at that communication, then we will probably get better at engagement, and people will feel as though they do have a seat at the table, whether it's a physical one or whether it's just an influential one.
I can maybe say one thing which would improve carers feeling like equal partners, and it comes up in our report, came up in many of our meetings, is, I've said this before, but resourcing things properly. And I think that if a carer turns up to a meeting and they're effectively out of pocket, or they're having to reduce the short breaks they have for themselves, then that's not really acceptable. Quite a lot of our carers attend a lot of meetings around IGBs and then some of the other groups that feed into them. At our last meeting, one of our carer reps said, that was in January, they said they already had 40 meetings in their diary in relation to meetings around the integrated authority. So that is a big time commitment. A lot of those people have caring responsibilities already. Some of them work, some of them are retired. But particularly, I would say, the ones who are employed and who are juggling employment as well. Some of them are self-employed. One's on a 0 hours contract, so they're physically out of pocket whenever they attend meetings. I think that's something that should be addressed. If you look around the table at an IGB, there's a lot of very well-paid people there. The carers are putting in significant number of hours, and I think that they should be looking at recompensing that. There is one example I know of in Scotland, which is the Highlands, where they have employed a carer both in terms of supporting engagement, but also the carer rep. In addition to the work he does on the IGB, they do employ him for some things on a consultancy basis. So it can be done, and I think it's something that other areas should be looking at, because really, to be equal partners, if you're not resourced the way other people in the room are, then I don't think that's equality.
Claire.
Thank you, Convener, I have to declare an interest as the MSP for Rutherglen, so I'm particularly pleased to hear that South Lanarkshire is doing so well in terms of engaging with FASLAN. And I wonder if perhaps you could give me an indication of if some of the good practice that's been spoken about today, if that's being captured, and how we're looking at rolling that out across the country.
In South Lanarkshire, we've got a number of events that are coming up where we're looking at community events where we're trying to get the health and social care staff who might not have worked with third sector before. So it's a way of getting them upskilled, because a lot of them don't actually realise what the third sector do. So we're trying from that side. We make sure, as I said before, that all of the information is getting passed through our newsletters and through social media. We've got our blog. We're constantly tweeting about what's happening. So to me, the communication levels have really greatly improved.
I guess I was looking to see if any of that sort of good practice is being captured and rolled out across other IGBs or other carer rep organisations. I'm keen to hear from the other members of the panel if that's the case.
I have to sadly have to say that I haven't seen any other areas of best practice other than what is going on in South Lanarkshire and North Lanarkshire. Where I have seen some good areas of practice is how some of the managed clinical networks engage with the service users. For instance, in the Borders, they're busy looking at how they can improve the services. So what they are doing is they're going to be hosting a series of roadshows up and down the catchment area to engage with service users of the diabetes services to explain to them what the situation is, what the challenges they are facing, what their proposals are, and getting users' feedback. But that's very much coming from the health board, the MCNs, leadership on that. From an IGB point of view, we haven't really been engaged in an awful lot of involvement best practice.
Examples of best practice right across Scotland, actually. So my theory has always been that if you collected all the best practice and applied it to every area, then you'd have your solution, actually. So there's best practice across recruitment, training, engaging carers, resourcing it, and making sure it makes a difference, and enabling carers to feed into strategies which make a difference to their lives. So, I mean, there's many examples in our report. One area that kind of comes up quite often is North Ayrshire, actually, where, for example, the carer rep was on the shadow board before the IGB was established, which meant they felt part of the process from the beginning. They also provided care awareness training to IGB members and local councillors to make sure that they had a good idea of the issues that affected carers. And the care reps led in that training too. They've also been very proactive in terms of, for example, co-producing their carer strategy and involving other carers in that. And that's not isolated. There are great examples, like I say, across Scotland. There are still areas of challenges and frustration, but I think from the beginning of our project last year to now, we're seeing that there's definitely an improvement.
And is there some sort of mechanism to capture that best practice? I guess as a committee, we've heard over numerous evidence sessions that there are excellent practices in lots of areas of health and social care right across the country. But it's about trying to capture that and roll it out so that everyone benefits from that. So is there some sort of mechanism or someone taking a lead in terms of finding out where the best practice is, looking at how that can be rolled out to areas which are perhaps not as up to speed?
In terms of just what we've done, and it is just for carers, so I can't speak for the other stakeholders, as part of our project we did a scoping exercise and we also collated the best practice just from what the care reps were telling us. So it is in our report, and then we produced recommendations which pulled together how you could look at the best practice and then implement it across Scotland. And the next stage is to try and work through the integrated authorities to do that. We're working closely with the integration team at the Scottish Government, and the care reps themselves are taking the report and trying to table it. A few have done that already to talk about how those recommendations could be implemented locally. I think more could be done, certainly, in terms of putting across those recommendations, because we're a very small organisation, actually, the coalition. There's only one paid member of staff, myself, and we've got a small grant to run this Cares Collaborative, so it's beyond our capabilities. It needs to be a much wider effort. But I think that it would go a long way to seeing improvements in terms of carers anyway, certainly on IGBs. Although the challenges are probably similar right across the board with all stakeholders, I would say.
And can I ask just finally then, how receptive have you found the IGBs to you presenting this works well in another area, or this has worked well in this forum?
This is quite an early stage. So the report was sort of published about a month ago, and we actually have a meeting of the care reps today, so I'm going to have to fly out of here and go to that. And they're looking at today how they're going to table it at meetings, but some have already, as I've said, and we'll hear today how that went, so I would be able to tell you afterwards. But we're hoping they'll be open to it, but we're not sure yet. We are also continuing with the scoping work, so we'll have another report in January to see how things have moved as well and what improvements have been made and whether or not recommendations have been implemented in that timescale.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, I was just going to come in on that my understanding, the only forum that we sit on is within Perth and Kinross, and that was kind of purely by default. But my understanding, sitting around those meetings who feed in to the IGBs, is that the representation from the Alliance was there to kind of support that and gather that information and then all feedback. So that could be one way of feeding back and sharing best practice, I would have thought.
I think there's a role for the Scottish Health Council within this, because they do have they have produced standards for engagement and involvement. They do the assessments on health boards. They have a lot of evidence on best practice. So I think there is a role for the Scottish Health Council within the best practice development formulae.
In terms of what's been discussed, what you've got experience of being discussed, is the discussions dominated by issues of service improvement or budget?
Budget.
Others?
Resource is a big issue. Fiscal resource, personal resource, information resource. Mm. There has to be investment in order to have improvement.
Mm. I mean, certainly the feedback I get from constituents is that the discussions are being dominated, and you know, the impression I get across country are being dominated by issues of concerns over the financial situation that these new organisations are starting life with, which is dominating proceedings rather than how do we improve the health and social care of the local community. Would that be a fair reflection in your experience?
Yeah, I think it's certainly what my experience has been. It's about getting them to see the bigger picture. Yes, we've got the initial issue sat there of the issues of finance, but it's about seeing the bigger picture, how third sector can actually help contribute and influence and scope the future development. You know, it's about investing the pennies to save the pounds, instead of keep focusing on, well, we're actually spending quite a few of those pennies. But it's about getting them to see the bigger picture and looking at person-centred services instead of just focusing on the budgets.
Who is it that's to see the bigger picture? Is it the IGB or is it higher up the chain? Is it government? Is it who?
I think it's one of that things, and I'm so glad that we've moved from, instead of the voluntary sector, to the third sector, because every time we heard the voluntary sector, people would think it was free. And I've constantly said that we still need to have resources for that. So that was my first point. I think it needs to be the bigger picture for the, all of the partners. It needs to be the IGBs, but it also needs to be the local authorities see that as well, that we need to be involving all of the communities and all of the stakeholders.
Yeah.
I think we could do with a greater degree of transparency as well, to be honest with you. So, for example, as part of the scoping work, we just did a simple look through the strategic plans, references to carers, and then the minutes as well to see how many times carers were referenced. There was only 17 references to carers across Scotland in the minutes of IJBs. Not to say they weren't discussed more, but their contributions weren't always minuted. And I think from a carer's perspective, what they'd probably like to see is a local carer strategy, very robust strategy, which then is reflected in the strategic plan, and you can follow the resources across as well, which is something you can never do. A lot of the strategic plans are very high level. They almost all mention carers as a priority, but it then doesn't say exactly what they're going to do and what resources go along with it. So I think, although there may be a lot of discussions around finance, it tends not to be discussions which the stakeholders can contribute to. Yeah. Can say, well, this is what we'd like to see happen to resources in our area, this is how they can be better used, this is how you might want to do things differently. And I think that needs to be part of it, where, you know, yes, budget and money does need to be discussed, but can it not be done in a more open way?
Anyone else? Miles.
Thank you, convener. As a Lothian MSP, I've been quite concerned for a while with some of the charities who have said to me that potentially some of the services which IJBs pay for but they do not refer or send patients to in the future could be looked at. Do you have any examples of that? Because it's quite clear if that starts to happen, other IJBs will be destabilising each other. And I just wondered if, from your background, if you know of any examples of that we should be aware of as well.
Can you explain that again? Yeah. Sorry.
So in terms of services, I've met with a number of charities who have expressed concern that currently their patients aren't referred to services which are funded by their IJB. And in the future, that could be looked at and that funding not allocated. And I think when you look across Scotland, there's a number of cases like that. And I think there's growing concern that if that actually starts to be a deciding factor around finance, that we could see IJBs destabilising each other. And I just wondered from your background if you had any examples of similar cases.
Then.
From a diabetes perspective, I think we don't provide services as a third sector organisation in the sense of we don't have ISAs, but we do provide services and support to the local authorities and the local community. Where we have found there are issues is actually within the budget allocation from within the health board. Some diabetes services have not had a budget uplift in several years, and yet the numbers of people with diabetes is increasing. So it's more from a statutory perspective. What we've also found is there seems to be a lack of transparency as to who is responsible for the operational management of the diabetes services. Is it the IJB? Or is it the health board? So there's confusion there. So from our experience, it's more within the statutory sector than actually third sector being funded for support services. Having said that, we do have some organisations that provide emotional support and health to people with diabetes. And some of those services are having their budgets cut, and some of those services no longer know whether they're going to be in operation next year.
One of the examples that we've been faced with is in sort of all the change around, despite, for example, chronic pain being a Scottish Government priority, if that does not form part of a respective health board's local delivery plan, there is no jurisdiction on them to fund it. So there's a bit of imbalance there, I would say. And looking at your sort of other question as well, when we attended a primary care conference back in January, one of the issues raised for GPs referring patients on, one of the reservations was, if we refer a patient on to third sector, how do we know that they're going to be there in a few months' time, given all the funding issues? So
it's most of our members are local care support organisations, so they tend to be kind of involved in more local negotiations, so it may not apply, but certainly some of their funding is shaky at the moment. Some areas, for example, funding's been cut, and quite a lot of areas are looking at putting out tender care services, despite the fact, you know, those services have been there for many years, are well established and very well respected by local carers. So I think it's a different funding environment for people, which is always difficult. And I would say there is some insecurity within the third sector because of it. And when you've got, for example, in the carers movement, the Carers Act coming in 2018, it should be a period where you're looking at providing more resources to carers, support and building up services in advance of the new duties. But we are in some cases seeing funding being reduced, which is not really the direction we'd want to be heading.
Certainly in our area, the local authority cut quite a lot of third sector organisations' funding, but we have 19 projects that were funded through the IJB. As part of our remit as the TSI, we monitor these projects on a quarterly basis, and from that we can see the great work that's actually been done. I've got one group that received a contribution of 88,000 over 2 years to develop a meeting place. They have 252 users per week. And I know that since between November and February, they had 43 referrals coming through health and social care of isolated individuals that needed that support. And some of these are quite elderly people that don't see anybody during the whole week. So there's a lot of really good work that's going on there that we've got the evidence to back that up.
And are you then making...
That report goes to the IJB so that they've got all of that information.
And do you also then use that to lobby those who are providing the grant, yes to your organisations, but also from a higher up level?
Out of the monies that was put forward, there was quite a lot were not back, but I think there was something like 75% that were accepted had matched funding from elsewhere to support that their applications.
Okay, we're just about out of time. Thank you very much for your attendance this morning, and we'll suspend briefly till we change the panel. Thank you. We now move to a roundtable session, also on integration authorities' engagement with stakeholders. We will go round the table to introduce ourselves. So, my name is Neil Finlay, MSP for Lothians, and I'm a chair of the Health and Sport Committee.
Hi, I'm Claire Hawkey. I'm the MSP for Rutherglen, and I'm the deputy convener of the committee.
Sorry, morning, colleagues. My name is Michael Kellet. I'm the director of Health and Social Care in Fife Partnership.
Good morning, I'm Margaret McKeith from Scottish Care.
I'm Miles Briggs, Conservative MSP for Lothian Region.
Not necessarily on. I'm Amy Dalrymple, I'm Head of Policy at Alzheimer's Scotland.
Donald Cameron, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Hi,
Hi, I'm Marion Slater. I'm a geriatrician and I represent the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh.
Good morning, I'm Alex Cole-Hamilton. I'm MSP for Edinburgh Western and Lib Dem Health spokesperson.
Christina West, Chief Officer for Argyll and Bute Health and Social Care Partnership.
Karen Curtis, Service User Representative on the Strategic Planning Group of the Orkney Health and Care Integrated Authority.
Alison Johnston, MSP for Lothian.
Hi, I'm Jo Gibson. I'm Principal Manager at North Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership.
Marie Todd, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Andrew Strong, Assistant Director at the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland.
I'm Colin Smith, MSP for the South of Scotland.
I'm David Small, Director of Health and Social Care for East Lothian.
Ivan McKee, MSP for Glasgow Proven.
OK, thanks very much. Sorry, Tom, you were... I wonder if I could maybe open up by just asking about your views of how the engagement process is going. Is it all smiley, happy and tickety-boo, or is it not? Who would like to open up? Yep, Margaret.
I think the level of engagement varies considerably across the country. I think in some health and social care partnerships, the independent sector's got a very positive level of engagement. In other areas, it's sort of tokenistic, and we're there because we really need to be. So, and I think the main sort of difference is the personnel that are in post in each of the health and social care partnerships, and that can depend on how they view the independent sector as a whole. So my brief answer would be it varies considerably.
Key point being that it's really down to personal relationships.
Personal relationships, yep.
Anybody else care to comment on that? Andrew?
I'd say from our research and the research of our third sector health and social care support team, there's a limited picture in terms of involvement is probably what I would say. So we've detailed in our written response people who aren't necessarily involved in the mechanics of the IJBs, so people who aren't there as the third sector rep, carers rep, or a rep of people who use support and services, they've often told us that they find it difficult to source information about what's going on locally, and that the wider public would maybe have some limited understanding and would find it difficult to engage as well. To support that, our third sector team has produced a range of resources, so basic information about what's going on the boards and about their commissioning intentions and the commissioning plans, but that only goes to some extent. And there'll be issues for national third sector providers as well, which I'm sure Amy will be able to kind of talk to. But one thing I would say as well from the start of this, that there's inherently an unequal relationship at the IJB governance level between the third sector, the independent sector, people who use support and services, and the statutory sector, because of the nature of voting rights, but also because of the number of people on those boards at the moment. So in some areas you've got 8 councillor representatives, 8 health board representatives, and then one person representing the whole of the third sector in that area, one person representing people who use support and services in that area, one person representing carers. And that inherently and knowingly from the start, from the development of this process, that's what we've developed, but it's an unequal relationship.
David?
Thank you very much, convener. I think it's probably early days, to be fair. Most IGBs have only been in existence for a year, perhaps a little bit more than a year now. So it is early days, and hopefully that experience is reflected across Scotland. In East Lothian, we took an approach of having a broader membership than the minimum required. So we have the independent sector, the third sector, carers and the public. There are 4 seats on the East Lothian Integration Joint Board that bring that other voice apart from the statutory members that were mentioned there. We're currently reviewing the way third sector membership is input to the IJB. Up till now, it's been the third sector interface chief executive. They've come forward with a proposal that they would like an election process within the third sector in East Lothian, which we're positive about and would welcome. And we're having a dialogue about the feedback mechanisms and how that person would be representative, if you like. But I think we're very positive about that proposal, and we expect to consider that shortly. We're developing a new engagement strategy because we recognise that the engagement we did early on about the strategic plan was for a particular purpose. It was about the strategic plan, which had to be in place by March 2016. So there's a particular kind of engagement we did around that, but we now need a more forward-looking engagement strategy, which takes us beyond that. So we're consulting on our engagement strategy for the future now. We do have development sessions as well as formal IGB meetings. We hold development sessions. So formally speaking, our IGB meets every 2 months, and in between we have a development session. So the next one, for example, is going to be about carers' issues, and that was proposed by our carers member of the IGB, so that all of the members, both formally and informally, could consider carers' issues and how they link into the strategic plan for the future. We do recognise we could do more, though. Our Older People's Joint Inspection Report from last year made some recommendations about improving our links with the third sector. So we recognise we've got some work to do, and that the substructure beneath our strategic planning process and the engagement that goes on with that, where we would get into the detail of individual strategies and client group issues, is perhaps not as robust as it should be. So I would say, in summary, it's probably work in progress, but I think we're making positive progress.
On the record, the four additional members do not have voting rights.
No, that's right. That's in the regulations. That's
it.
Yes.
Is there now? I can't recall this, but when it went through, but you cannot give them voting rights.
No, that's correct.
You don't have the leeway to give them.
The legislation is quite clear. The voting rights are the health board members and the council elected members. Yes.
I think in our area anyway, it's gone from being quite tokenistic to still quite tokenistic, but with slightly better support. In the last few days, I've just had emails that have finally recognise the difficulties that representatives and public representatives face, and starting to look at ways that might actually be addressed now. But it's still, as a service user representative, I just find my job absolutely impossible. I'm not representative. I cannot represent. I don't have any network to feed back to or to get information from. And even the process, which on paper looked really good for electing representatives, didn't really work, because in the first round of seeking representatives, nobody applied. In the second round, nobody applied, but I actually got asked by a friend who works in the third sector interface if I would apply. I was the only person who applied, and because I kind of ticked their criteria for someone who might be a representative, I got on. So I'm in no way a representative. And I think, having attended a few meetings now, I've come to the realisation that actually my job isn't as a representative. My job has to be as someone who monitors public participation. And I think that's a really key thing, that you cannot be representative at that level. But if I can monitor, if I can insist that participation happens at much lower levels, from bottom up, which is really where it ought to be, rather than from someone asking questions from the top down, then I think I might be able to get somewhere. But it is difficult when some of the other difficulties that people mentioned this morning about not being able to put things on the agenda, about the strategic planning group not really doing strategic planning, but a tick box exercise for things that have been presented with little opportunity for discussion. Just all those things make life a lot more difficult. And I think it's about the whole kind of focus, and it really does seem to be too much top down, including all the information that we're getting to make decisions on. It's broad statistics. It's not what people see working at the coalface, and that's where all the information should come from. That's where the public involvement should start, with talking with your health professionals and carers, and then that information filtering up to be used as valid information for planning. I don't see any of that happening.
Okay. Michael?
Thanks. Convener, just to echo what other colleagues have said, I think my summation, Chair, would be that it is a work in progress in terms of our ability to engage, and I would agree with David and others on that point. We're in a similar position in Fife to the one that David explained in East Lothian. We have four seats for the independent sector, a patient service user representative, a third sector representative and a carer representative, and those colleagues are active and vocal around the IGB table. But we are also in the position that Andrew explained, that we're a very large IGB, so we have eight elected members, voting members, and eight members from the health board. So the IGB table is very large. It's significantly larger even than this table. So there is an issue there for us, and I know sometimes those colleagues feel that they are challenged to be heard effectively. I think in Fife we've had done some work very well. So in terms of the strategic plan that was pulled together before I took up the post. There was extensive involvement there, and I think colleagues were supportive of the level of engagement there. We the strategic planning group, I think, as has happened in other parts of the country, thereafter felt unsure about its ongoing role, and that's something that we've been working with them to resolve. We're now at the position kind of looking forward around thinking how do we get into the genuine co-production mode with our partners, and there's a couple of areas where I think we're beginning to do that. We're looking, for example, about how we implement the Sir Lewis Ritchie review on urgent care in Fife. We've had stakeholders involved in that process from the beginning, but we're at the moment recruiting a mix of service users, staff and carers to help us conduct an option appraisal of the options for change around urgent care in Fife, and for me that feels more in the co-production phase. We also recently held with Scottish Care with the independent sector a Redesigning Care Together in Fife event at the end of March. Donald McCaskill, the CEO there, chaired that event. We had 70 people from across the spectrum. That the conclusions from that event will shape how we invest in new models of care in Fife moving forward. So those are examples of how we're moving into that phase, but I certainly think, as others have said, it's a work in progress, and I think that would be the case for all IGBs across the country.
Amy.
Thank you. One of the big things that's come up for us is the variability that there is, and so with that in mind, I'll recount a wee anecdote. I was at a meeting of an umbrella group of organisations, one of the several that we're involved with, and one of the chief officers of a health and social care partnership was there, and we were talking about the very difficult decisions around shifting resources to preventative and community approaches from acute care, and I made the point that we could help this group of mainly national but also local third sector organisations could help with the conversations around that and making sure that we were bringing the community with us in that decision-making process. And the response I got was, yes, it would be very welcome if we would help communicate why those decisions were made. And it was just a really good illustration of completely missing the point that I was making. And I think the point that's been made by people who were speaking in the earlier session and made by some of the other people around the table today, it's about bringing people with you. It's about doing things with people. It's not just about communicating a decision that's already been made. And that's a real misinterpretation, I think, of the term that you've used in your inquiry around engagement. You've also talked about stakeholders, and that's very different. And we're all coming from our own points of view. But from Alzheimer's Scotland, I come from several points of view with that. We're a national third sector organisation. We have several local services. We have local groups around the country of people with dementia and carers of people with dementia as well. And so we have a role in terms of making sure that individuals can be involved, what Andrew was referring to with, kind of people who aren't the reps. But we also can be a partner as an organisation in helping to improve care and support for people with dementia. And neither of those roles are really something that we're being used to the full extent around the country. There are pockets of good practice. Nowhere is doing everything right, though. Everywhere has got something to learn. And so even the places that are doing really well in some aspects, I think, need to come up to speed on other aspects. Lastly, I'd like to just mention about the need for involvement below the actual board level. We've been talking a lot about the IJBs, but in terms of locality level, and also for us, say the dementia leads and the dementia strategy groups or older people's mental health groups or wherever dementia is dealt with, it's really important that the involvement is not just at board level. That's tokenism as well. That's ticking a box. It needs to run right through the work of the Health and Social Care Partnership.
Christina.
I suppose in common with my colleagues David and Michael, I would share that in Argyll and Bute it is certainly a work in progress. We
in consulting on our strategic plan did, though, make some changes to the configuration of our locality planning groups. So we went from 6 to 8 in specific response to community feedback about their local communities and where they wanted to see a planning influence and an infrastructure created. And we saw things like community transport take a higher priority in our strategic plan, which hadn't previously been amongst our list of priorities. So over the last year, we've been trying to really support our locality planning groups to develop. And with 8 across Argyll and Bute, they all have carer representation, they have clinical representation, they have third sector representation as well. And we've developed health and care profiles, which actually say what the health and social care need in those natural communities are. And we've begun to provide information about how budgets are actually spent in those natural communities. So communities can become far better informed in terms of decision making about how resources are actually spent in meeting our strategic plan objectives. Each of our locality planning groups have now developed a locality plan, which is focused on how the strategic plan translates into local care delivery. But they need the information in order to provide that. And while we're beginning that journey, I think there's still an awful lot more detail that we can provide and a level of sophistication and analysis to help people understand the data we're actually providing them with to inform their decision making. So that is the level below the IGB, which we are, I suppose, taking the letter of the legislation, which was localities were the engine room of integration, we're trying very hard to support that bottom-up growth.
Marion?
I mean, I think it's clear that approaches to engagement, collaboration, board structure and governance arrangements are highly variable, and they're made harder by the scale and pace of change expected. Some of our fellows have had no engagement at all. Others are aware of the process, but have found that it's overly difficult to get involved with barriers to participation. Those that are involved have found that their role on groups are unclear, that there's little in the way of clinical input, and there's no real sense that our clinical voice is recognised or acknowledged, rather a sense of frustration that some IGBs appear not to value clinical opinion. I think opportunities to use frontline staff's knowledge, skill and expertise are being missed. And what really concerns me as well is the failure to use data to inform service change. Many of the proposals lack robust evidence, and I think more could be done to improve that.
And Jo.
Thank you. I would echo a lot of what's been said this morning. We in North Ayrshire are a year older than most of the other partnerships, although I'm sure it doesn't show. So we did do a lot of work at the beginning to try and create an inclusive ethos. And we heard from colleagues from the Carers Coalition this morning about the carers have been involved, as well as the third sector interface, as well as service users, and as well as the independent sector, from our shadow state into where we are today. We have focused, as many have described, initially on those very senior structures, so involvement in the IJB and the strategic planning group. We did that not only through the mechanism of the meetings themselves, but also with a lot of development and support behind the scenes, a lot of development days together where we shared information and got a shared understanding about what each colleague was bringing to the table. Since then, I think we've only seen the tip of the iceberg in terms of the potential. So with now developing the locality planning structures, that gives us architecture in each community and the chance to access the voice of communities. It also has opened our eyes up to how we can involve people in designing our services in a way that not only benefits citizens in that we design more efficient and effective services, but it benefits the citizens themselves in being involved, and we've seen lots of positive outcomes for individuals and groups because of that. The other thing we're seeing is people are beginning to mix up the hats they're wearing. So initially, our third sector interface colleague or our independent sector colleague represented just that view. Now we're using those skills and those individuals to do different roles in the partnership. So one of our locality forums is chaired by our carers rep from the IJB. One is chaired by our third sector rep. When we have commissioning decisions to make, we have set up small groups which are populated by that range of individuals to make those decisions and bring back recommendations to the IJB. So we're blurring those boundaries between the organisations and creating greater understanding because of that.
Marion suggested that the people's views were not being listened to and the input wasn't sufficient. In terms of the previous panel, we heard about the dominance of issues around finance dominating proceedings and the rest of it. So is there, or are there enough people involved in rolling out the engagement in this in order to capture those views? Is it a financial pressure that's preventing that, or is it the culture of the new organisations that's preventing that?
I think it's the culture of the organisations. I mean, I've been quite shocked, really, at the difference between the National Health Service of New Zealand and the National Health Service in the United Kingdom, just in the way the patient's views, or the patient is respected as a person with information and knowledge about their conditions, and their ability to talk to the professionals involved in their care. So I think it all kind of starts from that. But looking kind of wider at a policy level, I mean, I've been looking at a number of different documents, and one of the ones is the New Zealand Healthcare Better, Sooner, More Convenient. Now, that's about integration, and it's about integration between primary and secondary care rather than health and social care, but kind of fairly similar. But when I look at changing models of health and social care, which is the Scottish document here, the one thing that really kind of strikes me is that all the best practice examples in the Scottish document seem to be based on other people's best practice documents. Like, we have lifted this model from Alaska and we're trying it here. We have lifted this model from somewhere else and we're trying it here. Whereas the New Zealand one starts with, we saw what was happening at primary care level and we have done something about it. And I think that is a really big change for the UK generally, but for Scotland.
I agree that the focus has been initially, and I take it with the IJB chief officers and representatives around the table, you're all saying it's early days, it's a work in progress, so kind of we'll help you progress. But the focus has been so far on resource issues and structural issues as well. It's been a big structural thing, and partly, and you've seen the clash of cultures there. And the NHS is frankly one of the most hierarchical organisations I've never come across. When I first read the Royal College of Physicians submission, I was intrigued because our take on it is that actually health is very dominant as a sector in the health and social care partnerships, and it's very much driven by health decisions. And I was kind of, well, how can the Royal College of Physicians not, you know, their members not feel that they're being listened to? And then I realised it's because of the hierarchical nature of it, and that's a very different culture to the one that I would come from in the third sector and in the and in community development. And I think that that's a big cultural issue for us who are from that sector in terms of getting involved, because there isn't there are all these levels, and the levels don't speak to each other in a back and forth way. They issue instructions to each other or information to each other as requested, and that actually makes it harder for us to be involved. Let alone when the focus is not on collaboration, it is not on co-production, and is not on improvement in services, because they're busy trying to make sure that the IT systems speak to each other.
Please don't start on IT.
Yeah, you're Lothian, I know.
Marion.
I think the issue is more cultural than financial. I mean, certainly my experience is that the approach from the IGB where I work has been overly top down, and, you know, as has been alluded to in lots of the submissions, priorities seem to already have been decided beforehand with little scope for discussion or change. We've been asked to develop a hospital at home service, and I think there's really very little evidence of that. There was a large Cochrane review at the end of 2016 which suggested that when compared to in-hospital care, hospital-at-home services probably make little or no difference to the likelihood of admission or patient health outcomes. And the evidence of effect on length of stay or cost of the health service is also lacking, and yet that's what's being pushed, and there's plenty of resource to develop that. It's caused a lot of friction and tension within my service, because there are those that support the proposals and those that feel we really need robust evidence to support this. And yet that finance isn't available to us to to develop other services. So I think that comes back to the point that you were making, Amy, that although health is a large part of this, actually the experience is that frontline clinicians aren't being allowed to influence this. I mean, our acute services are overstretched as they are without expecting the same service to take on more developments. And the other issue that I think is often overlooked is the pressure on staff. I mean, we've got huge vacancies, particularly in community nursing, and I don't think that that is taken sufficient account of in many of the proposals that have been set out.
Hey, David.
I think this issue of clinical engagement is really important, and I guess it maybe depends partly on the services that are provided under the authority of each IJB. So, for example, in East Lothian, I think we might have one consultant who's a member of the Royal College of Physicians, but we might have 100 people who are members of the Royal College of General Practitioners. So we have a GP on our IJB, which is in addition to the statutory minimum of having the clinical director, who is also a GP. But we do have a consultant physician, a cardiologist from the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh. We also have the chief nurse and the chief social work officer. So that whole professional input to the IJB is very varied, and I think we mustn't miss the multidisciplinary nature of what we're trying to do. So we have deliberately gone for as broad a professional input to the IJB as we can. Again, back to the point, these are non-voting roles because of the statutory basis of integration joint boards, but it's important to have that diversity of input. We also have consultant psychiatrists inputting to our strategic planning group. And the issue of hospital at home is a really interesting one, because I think I take your point absolutely, but I think most of us are trying to develop some version of hospital at home in order to avoid unnecessary hospital admissions for older people or people with dementia or delirium, where it might actually be the worst thing for them. I appreciate there's evidence both ways, but I think it's one of the key tools we will have in the future to meet the aspiration to reduce unscheduled care bed days under the Health and Social Care Delivery Plan.
Based on evidence that you have?
It's based on practice from across Scotland. I think South Lanarkshire and Fife were one or two of the early areas, before IJBs even, who introduced hospital at home services, and they have produced evidence of reduced admissions, shorter length of stay, etc.
Michael?
Just to confirm what David said, that hospital at home has been in place in Fife for some time, and it's a key part of our kind of armoury moving forward around shifting the balance of care and keeping people at home wherever possible. But I take the point that Mary makes. I think that's a fair point. There is genuine kind of clinical difference in clinical views. Again, like David, I think the ensuring effective clinical involvement is a really important issue. We have a similar arrangement, as David describes, around clinical voices around the IGB table itself, but also in terms of the senior team that works with me in the Health and Social Care Partners. I have an associate medical director, an associate nurse director. We have a qualified social worker around that senior team as well, and that's a very important mix and ensures, I think it's a work in progress, that the clinical voice and the professional voice more broadly described, so housing professionals, social work professionals, are heard around these tables. The other point, Chair, I wanted to make, I think the discussion in the previous panel was interesting around how much time IGB spend on budget and procedural and structural issues as opposed to dealing with substance, I suppose. And I think that's been a real challenge, and it's potentially a factor of the relative infancy of IGBs. But we have spent a lot of time in Fife thinking about our budget and budgetary challenges. But just thinking back over the last few IGBs, we've discussed home care, we've discussed new models of community care, we've discussed mental health issues, and looking forward over the next couple of months, we'll discuss urgent care, community hubs as a prospect, but also implementation of the Carers Act. So striking that balance between having necessary discussion about difficult issues like budget, but also thinking about the substance is something that will be an issue for us moving forward.
Andrew?
Just on the point about culture change, really, and reflecting on the language that was used in the development of this legislation, were words like co-production, which Michael used earlier on. I was heartened to hear that in Fife there's developments around that, and transformational change. And I think this inquiry that this committee is doing is very timely in terms of that. But what we really need to look at is beyond consultation. We can't just be talking about consultation in this regard. We need to be looking at some of the examples that have been used around the table and how they can be rolled out elsewhere. The idea of co-production underlying the guidance is one which we wholeheartedly support and we want to see more of in the coming years. and take the point that we're in early days in terms of the development of some of the health and social care partnerships, but we want to see more of this going forward. One thing I would also say is that at strategic planning and locality level, we're probably more likely to see those things happening than we are necessarily at the top governance level with the IJB and then feeding into that. And that links to some of the points that have been made. So perhaps the committee could think about what it's doing in terms of asking questions of IJBs around those levels and what's happening in terms of co-production there. So yeah, I just wanted to make that point in terms of culture change.
Yeah, Margaret.
I think the independent sector is the biggest provider of social care within Scotland, but it's very disappointing that we've only actually got a seat on 7 IJBs across the country. The areas we do have seats on, like Fife, which Michael's made reference to some of the innovative work that's taking place there, to North Ayrshire and Argyll and Bute, we've got some really, really good really good partnership working. We're seeing some innovative approaches to service delivery, which is undoubtedly benefiting the people living in these areas. So I would, one of the things that Scottish Care is really keen to have is having a seat at each of the IJBs where we've got presence in the country.
Keen to bring in any of my colleagues who want to add any additional questions? Colin?
Can I just ask, one of the recurring themes is that there's lots of good practice out there, so how do we actually make sure that good practice is spread across Scotland? What's the mechanism that needs to be put in place, either at government level or at some other level, that will make sure that best practice is shared across Scotland and is implemented across Scotland where it's relevant?
Corinne.
I think the best practice is more about the how than the what. So it's more about where those ideas for innovative projects come from, where they came from, how people actually engaged at the bottom level to get those ideas coming up. So it is more about the liaison between the services and the people that use the services. And I know there is a lot of difference in the various areas around the country engagement practices. I mean, I know in Orkney we don't have a public engagement officer in the health board anywhere, and public engagement has been devolved to manager level of each area, but nobody's monitoring that, so nobody's actually seeing if that really happens. So I think, you know, something about looking at how engagement happens at all levels, particularly from the very lowest levels upwards rather than from the top down, would be one good thing. And showing people how to go about developing these innovative projects rather than replicating ones that already exist.
Jo.
I agree that I think we have a lot of the solutions between us already, but the job in these new integrated joint boards is relentless, and it has been from the start. So it does get very difficult to free up time to go and study elsewhere and what's happening and then begin a discussion about how you might apply that in your own patch. But I do think we have opportunities to do that through both colleagues in the Alliance and through what was referred to in the earlier session around the role of the Scottish Health Council. So we do already produce narratives about what we've achieved and what's worked well. It would be helpful if one of those national bodies were able to compile that in a way that's distilled for all of us to use. I know we now have a geographical link with the Alliance, who are beginning to do that, and we have a geographical link with the Scottish Health Council. If it was clearer that was their remit to share that information, that would be helpful. The other thing each partnership will be producing is an annual performance report. We get guidance from the Scottish Government about what should be included in that. It would be helpful for that to ensure we also reflect how engagement is working and that extracts from that can be distilled and shared so we all have something like a go-to toolkit.
Andrew Crass, is that something the Alliance is working on, or do you have funding to do that? Do you have a remit to do that?
Our third sector team is funded to provide a kind of clear understanding of the integration landscape, mainly around about the third sector's role and enabling the sharing of the sector's experience and creating connections between the third sector. So it's not technically within that remit, but it does, in some cases, we are looking at what is happening innovatively and trying to share that with our networks. So we have monthly integration forums with the third sector to share what's happening locally. We're hosting a range of strategic commissioning events at the moment, and 115 organisations are currently signed up to that across the country, and also sharing that through kind of regular newsletters and things like that. But that's, you know, we are attempting to do that.
Michael?
I think it's a very important issue, and it's not an easy answer. I think the Alliance has an important role, as Andrew and Joe have described. I also think there's a role for the national statutory bodies. David, Christina and I we have a regular meeting of chief officers every quarter, and we were at that meeting last Friday, and Healthcare Improvement Scotland came along to talk about the work of the iHub, which they've put together as a relatively new development about supporting improvement across health and social care. And one of the issues there they talked about is how they capture and spread best practice and work with the Scottish Health Council and work with our Voice initiative, which I'm sure the committee has heard of in the past, to try to capture some of that best practice. So I think, but I also think we as IGBs and as chief officers have a responsibility ourselves to exchange information and make sure we follow best practice. Joe's right, the job is busy and relentless, but taking the time to do that is important. I think also there's a role for Scottish Government who understand that. I've been involved in the steering group for the NHS event, the one kind of two-day big conference that Scottish Government organises in the SCCC in Glasgow, and I know that quite a lot of the content this year is about from IGBs around best practice. So that's one practical example of how best practice is spread, but I think it will be a constant issue for us moving forward.
If it's worth doing at all, and not just because it's in the legislation, but if it's worth doing because, as I firmly believe, you can use this to improve services, to improve outcomes for people, then it is worth putting the time into, and it is worth doing it properly, and it's worth prioritising in terms of resources and in terms of attention. A slight disagreement with Colin about a lot of good. There's some good practice. I wouldn't want to kind of like. There's not huge amounts around, but there is some. Organisations like my own can support good practice. We have a network of local groups, but we've got a national Alzheimer's Scotland infrastructure behind that. And one of the issues that we have in terms of engagement with the third sector is because it's done through the TSIs, and there's great variability around the capacity and even willingness sometimes of the TSIs to work with their members, and particularly to work with those of us who are national organisations. I think that there could be an improvement there. And in terms of the accountability that there is within the TSIs, I was very intrigued to hear about what David was talking about, what you're talking to your local TSI, is it Strive, around an election process, around how the third sector is represented on the IJB, because I think that that's a really important issue, and certainly one that I've talked to people who do my sort of job in other national organisations about, that there is a problem in some areas about can we actually engage with the TSI, not South Lanarkshire, I have to say, noting that the witness who was speaking earlier is still in the room. I think information transparency, greater information transparency, would really help that as well. So as well as using the national networks, we can do our job better, as in we can help share good practice if the information is there about who to share it with. It is very difficult in some areas to know who the most appropriate person is to contact. And chief officers sitting around this table do not want to be bombarded with inappropriate information and suggestions from organisations like mine or others who have been speaking today. But if it was more obvious who the right person was, who was making particular sorts of decisions, then we wouldn't be bombarding you and we'd be making sure that you had relevant information to your role and that others had information that was relevant to their role as well. There is a lack of transparency in many areas around who is in charge of what and who is accountable for what. Not just about, you know, kind of like who's in charge of engagement, and but also who's in charge of particular areas of care. That's not always accountable. That's not always obvious. There was one voluntary organisation that put in a series of freedom of information requests to find this out, because it's just not available anywhere obvious. So we can support the process of spreading good practice, but we can't do that unless we have the information available to let us know where that needs to be spread.
Alison, did you want to?
Thank you, convener. I probably feel somewhat depressed, actually, during this evidence session, having read the submissions and listened to the various contributions. I think if we have a situation where a service user representative has said, I'm not a representative, I'm, you know, monitoring public participation because it's simply impossible to engage more fully, there's an issue. And we're hearing a very similar message from the Royal College of Physicians and from the third sector. So it seems to me that this is cultural and structural. Now, I am hearing some positive suggestions that just because time is moving on, relationships are developing and it's getting better. But I'm just concerned about the length of time it's taken. And I just wonder if there's anything that we could be doing now to ensure that greater collaboration and engagement is taken seriously. I don't know who would like to respond.
Can I give an example from my experience in New Zealand? I was involved in a number of Ministry of Health working parties. They were looking at primary healthcare guidelines, but I think the experience is the involvement as a consumer representative. I was called there. Now, I was an equal partner on that. I had full voting rights, equal speaking rights, which was a little bit of a problem to some extent, because then the decisions that might have been made at the end, I was tacitly in agreement with, even though I may not have been. But I think I was definitely treated as an equal. I was actually paid as an equal. Because I wasn't being paid by my workplace, I was getting a day rate for attending the meetings. And I think that's kind of important as well, you know, especially for things like carers and service users who, like me, may have considerable disability that puts them at a disadvantage. I can't work full time, and yet I am spending time on this voluntary position, which takes away from my ability to do any more paid work, you know, that kind of thing. So it's about kind of respecting it. But I was on those committees to give my kind of perspective on issues, not to represent the views of people or the opinions of people, but to give a perspective from that point of view. But also, it was about having really robust data. I mean, I've been absolutely horrified at the lack of data that's come through the strategic planning group. You know, we've had this sort of really broad level statistical data, no analysis at all of how it relates to the local level, no analysis at all of some of the projects that we're being expected to say yes or no to, no analysis of what's gone on before, no good estimations of how much money this might save or what it might be doing differently. So there's been no real information to make a proper decision on. Now, I may not have understood that on some of the New Zealand committees, but we actually had a researcher who read through all the stuff, who graded evidence, who pointed out stuff to us as we were discussing, you know, well, that fits with this, that doesn't fit with that, you know, that sounds really good, but we don't actually have good quality evidence to show it, you know, that kind of stuff. We had it accessible to us, so you didn't need to have this high-level understanding of things in order to be able to discuss it at a high level.
Is that peculiar to your area, or is that happening across the piece? Because if it is, then we have a real problem. If major decisions about the use of public funds are being taken with no evidence base, then that flies in the face of the whole approach that's supposed to be being applied to public services, which is that we have evidence-based policy. David.
I was just reflecting on what you were saying, and the East Lothian Strategic Plan, you can find it online if you're interested, does have all the data is down to the two locality level. East Lothian's geography is obviously very different to Orkney's, I appreciate that, and we've gone for two localities, East and West, so you'll find that it does analyse down to East and West locality level on things like use of medicines, disease prevalence, length of life, etc. All of that is in there. But I do think we've probably got a bit more work to do on developing meaningful local plans, because quite a lot of our services are provided across East Lothian and don't distinguish between the two localities. So it's what do we build bottom up based on this data that we've got, and how can services be responsive to the differences between East and West, because they are different. The town of Musselburgh is very different to the town of Dunbar, and the needs are different, and the problems that service users experience are different. So I think we've still got some work to do. So if this was part of that context of work in progress, and we're all trying to do the right thing to improve engagement, to improve our services, then I would go with that point. Perhaps on a general point, across Scotland there will be hundreds of people involved in integration joint boards and strategic planning groups from all sorts of backgrounds, members of the public, members of local third sector organisations, national ones, Scottish Care, etc., members of professional representative bodies. There will be hundreds of them across Scotland. And I think it's back to that question of how do you get the breadth of that experience across Scotland to get a general feel for how it's going across Scotland, because I think it is early days, and I think we will find there are areas where it's not so good, there are areas where it's better. Even in one partnership you'll find things that are not going so well and things that are going very well. So I do think there's a challenge in bringing all that together, and I did like the suggestion of perhaps on that national annual report from IGBs, which will be coming up soon, there's maybe something about how we include engagement and get the voice of those who are engaged, as well as the voice of people like myself and Michael writing stuff in a performance report in that.
Do you recognise what Corinne's saying there, or is that
not
just...
Don't, no.
Not at
no.
all, no.
No, I don't recognise that for East Lothian.
I'm sure there are some excellent examples of data collection, but the feeling overall is that it isn't being used properly. I was quite astonished by the Care Inspectorate's response and the examples that are given. None of them have any evidence associated with them, not even qualitative evidence. It's just a wellbeing officer went in here, and we feel that this is a truly innovative use of service. And it maybe is, and I'm sure it's making a difference to people, but then they should be measuring that. Sorry, I think it was you, Joe, said about what can we... Oh, no, sorry, it was you that said, what can we be doing now to improve things? And I think we can start collecting data now to evaluate these projects. That's something we can do today. I think each of these projects that started, each of these projects that's taken forward, we need to start collecting the data to show whether it really is making a difference to service or not. And just to briefly come back to the hospital at home in relation to that, I'm not against hospital at home at all, and I think we've got some excellent examples of how that works. It's just the whole reason for the data collection is that we have to bear in mind that expanding services outside the hospital can mean uncovering previously unmet need or providing extra services that people are going to use on top of those that already exist. And we can't assume that preventing admissions means that all associated costs can be chalked up as savings. And that's why we really need to be getting robust data, because as you say, it's public resource and we should be utilising that in a responsible way.
Andrew?
My point was less about data, although I think the point that's made about monitoring and evaluation, I mean, going back to the point about budgets, I think that there's an issue there around about budgeting to make sure that monitoring and evaluation of key projects actually happens, because the budget, what usually happens in times of austerity is that things like that fall away. But my point goes back to what Corinne said at the start of the contribution around about accessibility of boards and planning mechanisms, etc. And I thought you hit the nail on the head, to be honest, in that if we truly value public involvement in some of these boards, we need to pay for it, and we need to budget for it, and we need to make sure that people are able to attend, that they're financed to attend. And I think that actually applies as well to the third sector interfaces and their role in this, because they don't get the level of financial capacity to be able to complete this role in my view, and that's why we've got such a patchy picture. In terms of accessibility, RNIB Scotland have recently made some asks of integrated boards around about accessibility for people with long with visual impairments, and that will go for other organisations as well. And if we're taking a human rights-based approach, we need to make sure that things like respite are available for carers to be able to engage in this, that disabled people get access to the meetings, that they get supported to and from meetings, and that we budget for things like expenses and overnight stays. Those are the kind of mechanics behind good, valuable involvement in these things. We need to make sure that they happen. It comes back to the point that was made earlier on as well about the Scottish Health Council's participation guidelines. And those, we really need to make sure that those are put in place for some of these boards, that actually happens.
In terms of your own organisation, do the people who are involved with your own organisation, do they get compensated or paid for their involvement in your organisation?
Yes.
Thanks. Michael.
Thanks, Chair. Just a couple of comments on data. I think, as colleagues have said, I think there's consensus around the table that's really important. We're in a similar position to the one David described. We have seven locality areas in Fife, and we have, and that's relatively recent, I have to say, developed detailed descriptions of the health and social care issues and around those individual communities. We're not as advanced as Christina is in terms of putting those locality groups together, but when they are, and that's an immediate priority, then they will there'll be really valuable data about the particular issues in each of those communities. So that's in place. I also think, though, as a colleague from the Royal College said, that we need to have data around policy developments to assess them and understand whether they're worth rolling out. And that's something, certainly in Fife, we're very keen on. We've put in place a new model of reablement, home care reablement, over the last year called START, which is designed to support people getting out of hospital quickly, to assess their needs over a short period of time, and to, where possible, if that's appropriate, kind of ensure they get the right level of support, not just the level of support they were initially provided with. And that's beginning to show real benefits, but that's because we're monitoring, we're evaluating, and we're recording that data, and that will inform its onward development. The only other thing I want to say, I mean, I think Alison's challenge around this feels quite depressing is a fair one. I think, I suppose, from my perspective, the real light at the end of the tunnel here around engagement has to be around, we need to get it right at the IGB level, and we need to take into account all the points people have made today. But the real kind of opportunity here, I think, is at the locality level. So in Fife, in those seven localities, David's two and Christina's, I think you said you had eight localities, Christina. And that's where, as Christina said, there's the engine room of integration was designed to happen. And that's where I think there's real opportunity for service users, carers, patients, families, those providing services, those managing services, to get together to shape and inform the delivery of services moving forward. And that's where I think the real opportunity for co-production is. And so for me, that's the light at the end of the tunnel that we need to keep our eye on moving forward.
Joe?
Just a couple of points. I would like to say that I don't recognise what Corinne has described about her experience at the Strategic Planning Group, and I very much hope all my colleagues on our Strategic Planning Group would agree with me. Our first strategic plan was based on a very detailed needs assessment that was available to everybody, but that was brought together by a range of professionals. So we clearly based decisions on what we understood were the issues in the population at the time. Since then, the Strategic Planning Group has received, they receive our quarterly performance report and consider in detail what progress we're making against our strategic plan. We have also shared with the Strategic Planning Group the locality profiles that others have described, where we've built up a document detailing everything we know about each locality. So we try and include, enable the Strategic Planning Group to be as informed as us, so that when we make decisions about commissioning, everybody has the same amount of information. We've recently brought forward a medium-term financial plan, and that has very much helped us in the last budgeting round, because that has laid out the scale of the challenge before us over the next 3 years. We spent some considerable time with the Strategic Planning Group a few weeks ago going through the detail of that medium-term financial plan, so we all have that shared understanding of where we're going. In terms of the question about data and evaluation, I totally agree, and I'm sure you have rehearsed many times some of the complications around information and information governance.
we did early on decide to invest some of our integrated care fund money in a group of people that we called the change team. And in that group, we ensured we had skills around information analysis, evaluation, project management, and OD support. What that's meant is when we've embarked on a change, we've taken the time to study the data, both quantitative and qualitative, beforehand, and then we could see changes as we move forward. And one of the things I'd like to share with the committee that has enriched this greatly is we've used peer researchers to help us understand the impact of that service for both service users and their families. And we've trained and supported peer researchers and reimbursed them where we could to do that. That's worked well in a number of projects so far, and we're working to train a larger cohort of peer researchers over the next year so we can build on that.
Christina.
I'm going to pick up Alison's specific question, which was, what can we do to enhance greater collaboration and engagement? And it's a concern that my own IGB have raised. Over our first year, we've embarked upon, I think, a series of ambitious changes, and some of those in terms of our communication and engagement have gone less well than others, and that's a lesson that the IGB have sat down and considered very carefully. And as a result of that, we are going to be investing more dedicated resource in communication and engagement resource, but specifically to target and support our locality planning groups. Getting the case for change out there and being well understood by communities is a real challenge for us. We've had, I think, very fair accusations levelled at us about our use of jargon, about our use of data and analysing it and making it easily explainable. So the IGB in turn have used that, and I think our lessons learned over the past year, hoping that going into this year that investment will actually help us focus in a more meaningful engagement process. Yes, we have got that locality infrastructure, but the feedback we're getting is the message still isn't understood about the case for change. People understand that there is a fiscal challenge and that's something we need to address. But actually the other challenges in Argyll and Bute are about a diminishing population. They're about a significantly increasing population with an over 74% increase in our over 75s by 2035. We know that our workforce will decrease by 14% and we're already beginning to see recruitment challenges. The totality of that is actually what is facing us as a health and social care partnership, not just the budget. And so it's really important that in our communication and engagement that we're letting communities understand actually what the challenges we're facing so that together we can decide what the future looks like. And I think that's really what the focus of that investment will be going forward.
Okay. Donald, you want
to... I want to pick up on that final point, because obviously we talk about stakeholders. The general public is one of the key stakeholders in all of this. Just firstly, an observation. There was talk from Marion and also from David about the role of clinicians internally. I actually think that can be taken one step further, and clinicians have a role, a public-facing role, when change is necessary. And often I think people trust a doctor or a nurse when there's a case for change more than they will someone in NHS management or even an elected politician, because they are able to provide clinical or medical reasons for change. And I think that's a very powerful role. So I think that can be taken further. I really want to ask about, there's a petition that's before this committee, petition 1628, which is about a care home, principally initiated by a care home in Dunoon, which Christina will know about, Struan Lodge, where many of the issues that we've talked about this morning are encapsulated. The real problem is that there is a lack of engagement, and this is especially in I think rural areas. I don't think it's confined to that, but there is a lack of engagement with local communities. And this petition, and I should pay tribute to Max Barr, who is the petitioner, reveals this. To put it bluntly, the local community don't feel involved. They feel that the engagement that has existed is superficial. They feel decisions are predetermined. The community health forum don't feel informed. And often, as is often the case, it takes the formation of an action group or a local media campaign or the involvement of local politicians to really ratchet up the pressure. So my real point, and I'd be grateful for people's views on this, is that you know, there is a gap, and all the good work you talk about internally about strategic planning, locality planning and co-production, all of which is important. There's a real gap between that and the general public and how that, you know, and how changes are achieved with the, you know, with the general public's support. And I think the petition about Strew and Loss just focuses a lot of that. And I'd be very keen to hear what the solutions are. How do we... Because a member of the general public will only hear that their local care home is closing. They won't... That is the message that is coming across. How do you advocate and get support for controversial change in these areas?
The points you raised were covered when we had the sessions with Scottish Health Council as well. Mm. They came up as well about service redesign and change. Anyone want to begin on that? Amy?
When the first thing the public hear is that their local care home is closing, that's, I think, where the problem is. If the first thing the public had heard was that there were difficult decisions to be made because of a decreasing population and a pressure on resources, and we needed to work together to figure out a solution, then there might not be this air being uninformed. It requires a real culture change to work like that. I referred to the NHS being hierarchical. It's also it's government, isn't it? And so are local authorities and health and social care partnerships. IJBs are creatures of both, and neither of the institutions that have come together to create these bodies are really used to stripping back and letting the public see the mechanisms of how they work. And that means that you get a fait accompli. You get a decision that has already been made. You get the public hearing that the care home is closing. You don't get a feeling of involvement. So having the courage, and this is what co-production is about. It's not about consultation. I've seen in a report by... I genuinely can't remember where it was, a health and social care partnership, saying we co-produce this by consulting people, you know, and the two things are entirely different. Co-production is actually about going back, not to when you make a decision, but to before you even know what decision you need to make, before you even know that a decision needs to be made, but saying, you know, kind of, here is our locality, here is our community, and what are the issues that we need to address in it? It's not even about saying these are the issues. The data helps, absolutely. But it's also about what the members of that community feel that those issues are. You know, there may be some aspects that actually the data would present as a problem. But actually, the people in that community feel that they manage together quite well. If they're allowed to get on with it and do things the way that they want to. And I see my fellow panelists from the Isles in particular nodding at that. You know, kind of, I think that's something that I've seen in Ireland and rural communities in particular. So it's actually about going right back to the beginning there and involving people. And that is going to take courage, and that is going to take culture change. And that's something that, you know, from our, I'm not going to say side of the table because we're all interspersed, but, you know, kind of from our side of things, we're well aware of the massive change that is going to be. But we are here to support that to happen, and national, local, third sector organisations, community groups, all, you know, kind of individual activists are here and can make a contribution to that and can support these big organisations with that change and with that culture change. But it's about admitting that needs to happen and having the courage to strip back and expose the bits that, you know, kind of maybe a bit mucky and need a bit of oil to stop them creaking.
Christina?
I'll I suppose respond to the generality of the question that Mr. Cameron's asked. I do think that a particular challenge we have, as I've already said, is getting people to understand the case for change.
The difficulty, I think, specifically when we look in localities, is that we need people to understand the whole system. And while we're trying to shift the balance of care, what we will see is individual buildings and beds become the focus of the discussion of local communities. And that will be because they have a genuine confidence in that service, they have had good experiences of that service, and any change in that service they see as a reduction or a diminution of that service. So having a conversation, as Amy says, about and actually laying bare the facts that we're facing, which are actually we cannot continue to deliver services in the way that we are, not just for financial reasons, but because actually we don't have the workforce to provide the service and we can't meet the increasing demand based on our current models. That does require a very different kind of conversation. So I think getting people to understand the enormity of the challenge, which is the one that we're facing, is really important. But the currency of buildings and beds is also a really important issue for us because we are charged with shifting the balance of care. Therefore, we need to develop confidence in our community services. And an Acumen service user said to me recently, Christina, we need communities to have sufficient confidence in their community services, the type of confidence they have when they see a building with a front door. And I don't think we're there yet. I don't think we're there in terms of building confidence in communities that the service that you can receive in your own home can be as safe and as effective and as high a quality as the service you receive in a building. And so people will fight tooth and nail to save the service in the building. So that is a particular challenge that we're facing. Certainly when it comes to care home capacity across Argyll and Bute, we have a very mixed economy and we have a huge variation in the cost of care provided in our care home sector, whether that's our own local authority provision or independent sector. And so while we're talking about shifting the balance of care, people often think about acute to community services, but actually I'm also thinking about bed-based care in residential care homes and whether or not we should actually be supporting more people to be actually cared for in their own home. So we need to see that shift not just from hospitals into community, but also from residential care into home care services as well. Without a doubt, the timing, our engagement around Struan Lodge, I personally and the IGB have said to the community, we've apologised, we didn't get it right. There was an absolute error in judgment in terms of making decisions that were very focused on budget. Due diligence had identified a £1.58 million deficit in May. We'd already agreed our budget and our savings plan, and then we had £1.58 million of savings that we needed to identify related to social care. And so changes were accelerated in a way that I don't believe the IGB will ever do again. And I suppose that's the learning that we've had this year. We accelerated decision making. We didn't take the time to go out and communicate with our communities, with our stakeholders. We didn't take the time to actually explain a case for change and why this needed to be happening. So lessons learned for us without a doubt. But I suppose going forward, they're very valuable, if not painful lessons. Yes, we did respond to that feedback we got from communities. We agreed as an IGB in November to take a 6-month pause in the changes that were being put on the table for Struan Lodge. And we undertook 19 community engagement events, 190 people turned up, 45 questionnaires were responded to, and the Struan Lodge Development Group have come up with an action plan of different proposals for how Struan Lodge might be used in the future. We now need to consider the totality of that feedback because there's no consensus. And as you would anticipate with any community, there are a range and diversity of views that have been expressed, which see us either disinvesting from those 12 residential care home beds and using that resource as a community hub, which was what the proposal was, which was having a hub for support for carers, reablement services, signposting people, and actually using the available infrastructure locally through independent sector to provide residential care, or whether or not we actually maintain that local authority provision in Dunoon. So that's still a discussion it's still a discussion to take place at the IGB. We will absolutely take account of all of the feedback that we've had, but with engagement comes a diversity of views, and the IGB will need to consider that in the round at its meeting in May.
Donald, do you want to ask any further?
I'm grateful to you for that explanation, and I do hope
I hope the that when the IJP considers it in May, they do take on board the very strong feelings that are apparent here. I think what Amy said is very right. Often the public feel that a decision is taken, and then everything therefore that follows is tokenistic. I think the phrase has been used, and I think the challenge is to reverse that process, as you say, and to start with an open book, genuinely with an open book, and bring people with you. And I'd be grateful to hear what others around the table have to say about that.
Corinne?
I have some quite strong views on consultation, having been involved from both sides of it. I mean, I have been used as a consultant to get consumer views on things as well. But I think I hear a lot of different things. One thing I hear is consultation fatigue. You know, we don't bother asking people because there's too much consultation fatigue out there. To my mind, consultation fatigue happens when the public gets asked too many stupid questions. It's things like, please comment on the 64-page strategic plan. No. Please, you know, give your views on one aspect of it, maybe, but not that. So real questions really gets real answers. Another example of that was, what was deemed as a quite successful social media consultation where apparently 125 people were involved in it. Well, I think the person that was counting forgot about spiders and bots on Facebook that boost the numbers for that. You know, there really wasn't 125 people involved. There was about 4 people that actually said anything real. And that was in response to a general question from the person leading the discussion on what would you like to say about the strategic plan? Again, sorry, too big a question. And then when you did say something, it was, that's really interesting, we'll note that. Yeah, where did it go? I don't know, you know. So I think just that kind of thing, people need to understand what real communication actually is and what real learning from the people they're consulting with is. And I think we're missing a huge big opportunity. I look on patient opinion every now and again from my local area to see what people are saying. Well, actually, they don't say much because they've learned that you give your opinion on patient opinion about a service and what you will get back is a really stock standard response. I'm sorry you had this experience. If you contact me directly, we'll see what we can do to make it better. That doesn't do anything. What you should be learning, you know, all the people that are looking at these, responding to these sites, is, okay, this person has an opinion, a problem with the service here. Does anyone else have that problem? You know, is it a systemic problem? What can we do about that problem generally, instead of just seeing it as one individual has had a bad experience, we're sorry about that. You know, those are the ideal opportunities for actually finding where changes could happen. I could give you dozens of examples of wasted services in Orkney, particularly where people have had to either travel from the Isles to the mainland for something or have had to travel from the Isles down to Aberdeen for something. Now, the number of wasted trips to Aberdeen, it's just shocking. It really is. And all of those from my island also involve an overnight stay somewhere. Because you cannot get down to Aberdeen in a day and back. So I think learning from people's experiences of that, but I don't know where to point people to get those recorded even, let alone acknowledged and done something with. And I think there's huge numbers of that kind of experience that you could be learning from in order to make plans about what's working, what isn't working, where we might want to shift resources. The other point I wanted to make is just about the whole kind of service user role. I don't think it is to help you make decisions. I think it's to give the information to help the professionals make the decisions. And I've come to that from an experience in New Zealand where it was the beginnings of the mental health service user movement in New Zealand. And the professionals were starting to listen to the experience of people who'd used mental health services. And I was working with a patient organisation who realised that it wasn't about telling the services what we wanted in the way of services. It was about actually just saying what our experiences of using the services were, and then that would give the clues for the people making the decisions about where things needed to change. And I think that really telling the stories made the biggest difference rather than giving recommendations.
I'd just like to build on a couple of points that both Christina and Corinne have raised. I think in our existence to date as health and social care partnerships, we have not done a lot to promote our existence to our public. And neither has that message gone out nationally very strongly. So the fact that we exist and that our responsibility is to shift the balance of care, I think we could do with some help in informing the public that that is the case. I think we have a responsibility to do that locally, but I think a national campaign to support us would help. I think then, secondly, that the scale of that challenge, we are trying to gain understanding of that, share the understanding of that locally, but again, if that could be supported nationally, that would help. But I just want to share one little story about how I think we are beginning to stop thinking these are the problems that we need to discuss with the public and instead try and create the context where the public identifies the problems and we work together to address them. So one of our locality forum members shared a story where she was in her kitchen and her daughter was sitting at the kitchen table with seven friends. And one of the friends identified that she'd recently started to take antidepressants. And slowly over the course of the next half hour, I think seven of the eight young people admitted that they were on antidepressants. So our locality forum member was unsurprisingly shocked about this. She brought this to a discussion at the locality planning forum, where the local GP was able to say, I'm not surprised. And in fact, we feel like we meet person after person who's describing anxiety and stress, and we feel that we have little option but to prescribe antidepressants. Once that conversation had happened in the locality forum, we took that to our locality forum network, where all six locality forums were present, six lead GPs, as well as six IJB members. We had a discussion about that. Then we looked at the data, and that was actually confirmed in the data, in our prescribing data, but also in recent research about the levels of stress and anxiety faced by young people in North Ayrshire. Then we were able to make different decisions. So already we have put community connectors in surgeries providing advice on mental health and wellbeing. We worked with Scottish Government and set up a participatory budgeting event on mental health in that area and allocated £50,000 to community groups and individuals who had ideas about that. And we've commissioned the third sector to try and develop a specification for us about what a low-level effective mental health service would look like for North Ayrshire. So I think that's an example about shifting the conversation to letting the public and community identify what matters to them and we respond with them. I'm hoping that is maybe slightly less depressing than where we began.
David. Reflecting on what Christina was saying, I think we've had an experience in East Lothian, which actually started in 2011, long before the Integration Joint Board, when we were reviewing the future of two community hospitals. And it was actually, this was before my time as well, there was a proposal to close them. And the negative reaction that came from that is still with us now in 2017. I think we're only just now getting over the history of that negative reaction and starting conversations with the communities again about those two facilities and what they could be in the future and how they can be not just health services but joint health and social care services, the idea of them being hubs, all that is now back on the table, but it's taken 6 years to get that trust back that we can have those conversations, and even then it's still very difficult and there's a lot of suspicion, so it takes time. And I think the lesson for me is to start early, start before you even know exactly what the problem is, and certainly before you think you know what decision needs to be taken.
Okay, I'm going to wind up just now, but I just want for the people in the IGBs to confirm whether they have set their budget, final budget for this year. We've been debating this about last year's budget, so we're now at this point in the financial year. Have you set your final budget for this year?
I'm happy to go first. Yes, we have. We've received the council's budget. It's been accepted by the IGB. That was accepted at the end of March. The health board set its budget on the 5th of April. So we had an indicative proposal from the health board that we discussed at our IGB meeting at the end of March, which was agreed. We don't anticipate the final offer to be any different. So, yes.
Okay.
Michael? Sorry, Chair. I'm pleased to say that we're in a similar position. So our 17-18 budget for delegated and managed services was approved by the IGB on the 23rd of March, The total budget for Fife IGB is £475 million. The budget doesn't quite balance, I should be clear. We have a remaining budget gap of £2.1 million that we have to manage in the course of the year. There are clearly pressures on the budget that we debated and acknowledged during the budget setting process, but the budget was approved on the 23rd of March.
Notification of both delegations of budget, but the IGB have not yet accepted the budget, as we do not yet have a plan that allows us to deliver all services within the delegated budget that we've been provided with. At the moment, what we have is a quality and finance plan over the next 2 years, which has a £20 million funding gap. Of that gap, we have £11 million in year one and £9 million in year two, and we haven't yet identified all of the service redesigns, savings, proposals, etc. for year one. So there will be a further discussion with the IGB at the end of May around that.
And those, that will be the IGB identifying what you view as the savings rather than the community identifying what should go into that plan.
We'll be informed by some of the when we started our budget setting process, we actually asked our LPGs to come forward with ideas of redesign which would fit with the strategic plan. So our quality and finance plan and developing it over 2 years started in October last year, where we asked our communities, what are the priorities, what are the redesigns you want to see in localities. The ideas that they came forward with did not meet the budget gap that we had, so we've had to obviously work with LPGs, and we've obviously had to work as a management team to identify further redesigns that can allow us to meet that budget gap.
So we, you know, just to be clear, we see those redesigns being driven by budgetary process rather than service delivery and service improvement.
All of the savings we've identified thus far, we are confident are complete, alignment with our strategic plan. We're very, very confident about that, which is why the IGB were happy to agree them at the last meeting. The issue is we have a £2.8 million gap for this year, and the any proposals coming forward haven't yet been aligned against the strategic plan, which is why the IGB haven't made their decision yet. And I suppose that will be the decision.
In your view, then, You think you can implement those cuts, I will call them, with no impact on service?
There will be an impact on service, without a doubt.
That's fine. Thank you. Jo?
Our IJB agreed its budget on the 9th of March based on an indicative budget from the NHS and a council meeting on the 1st of March. That budget did include £5.3 million worth of savings which have been identified and approved. We do still have a £1.2 million gap in terms of savings on the NHS side. We've brought forward some proposals about that that have been unpalatable to all concerned, and so we're back to the drawing board on that. But the only place we can go to for savings on the NHS side is on community services, because we can't reduce funding in primary care and we can't reduce funding in mental health services. Anything we do to reduce service in community care flies in the face of shifting the balance of care and our strategic plan. So at the moment, we're in a very difficult position. Negotiations continue. I have no further information.
You've probably observed this committee before and you'll be familiar with this, but if they were savings, then why would people object?
We needed to make a 4% saving on the NHS side. We have achieved much of that, but there's still a gap. Because of the ring-fence nature of the NHS services and because of the essential need to develop community and primary care and mental health services, we are in a very difficult position, as other boards will be also.
People who are being affected by those savings do not perceive them as savings.
So the ones like Christina has pointed out, where we have made savings, that's been in redesign, so actually we're going to provide a more effective and hopefully more appropriate service for people. And they have all been in line with the strategic plan and have had wide consultation and involvement. The remaining 1.2 million, we're not clear where that's coming from, and conversations will continue. I foresee that unless something changes, that does mean service reductions in areas that are crucial to our communities.
Doesn't sound very much like savings, but anyway. Could I thank everyone for their attendance this morning? It's been much appreciated, and please keep an eye on the further developments in this area that the committee's work. Thank you very much. Yeah, we'll suspend for a short break. Agenda item 3 is an opportunity for members to discuss the main themes arising from the informal evidence session with NHS senior managers held last Tuesday. Could I invite any comments from members on that session, please? You are not usually this shy and reticent. Alison.
The group that I was involved in discussion with were certainly of a view that raising concerns was difficult, that they didn't want to speak out, that it could be perceived negatively and perhaps have a negative impact on any career progression and potentially with relationships with other colleagues. So, it certainly didn't feel like an open culture in which issues could be discussed without an element of concern. I think that's the impression I had from the group I was with.
Anyone else like to contribute?
Just a background question, if that's okay, Convener. What was the kind of rationale behind using that union in particular? Was it just because it represented people in management level in healthcare, or
which union was that?
The union that everybody, well, I think MIP, yeah, that was union.
Sorry.
So on the papers last week, it said there.
There was a few trade unions represented in that. So it was just
right. So why that union? Just because they're healthcare managers, as it were. Yeah, because their membership UK level is 6,000, but in Scotland they've only got, well, at the last time, at the last count, was about 500 members, so that's about 8% of their membership, so they're not necessarily that well represented in Scotland. So I just wonder how representative they are of healthcare managers more broadly. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think probably because they're, you know, an organisation that's got a collective voice, if you like, that be we might have struggled to get others.
One of the things that struck me was some of the people that I was talking to had a remit that was UK-wide. Uh-huh. And they spoke very positively about NHS in Scotland in comparison to the rest of the UK, and particularly about privatisation of the NHS and in England in particular, and their concerns that the impact that had on staffing there. So they wanted to, they did ask to draw the contrast between the two systems.
Anybody else? I mean, the group that I sat with were all Scottish-based staff members, and they were raising quite significant concerns about the kind of culture that goes from ward level up through the system, and the way in which it stifles, in their view, stifles innovation and stops people taking risk that's positive risk in terms of developing service and that type of thing. And the way in which there was one individual who had been a manager and had experienced quite significant in the terminology now would be bullying and harassment in her role, having raised a series of concerns. But the overwhelming thing I think they wanted to contribute was about pressure felt having to deliver targets. I think that was the main thing that they felt, that the pressure to continually deliver those targets took over everything else, and that some common sense things that they would like to have seen brought in their service area or in their ward or whatever, or the area in which they manage, get put aside because the overwhelming pressure is to deliver the target, to deliver the numbers. And I think that was, they seen that as a negative in their experience.
I think as we take forward report or whatever, it's going to be quite difficult sometimes to make these voices heard, especially those who maybe approach us as individual members or as MSPs to express real concern about bullying and harassment, sometimes by senior advisers within the health service who report to ministers in Parliament here. And I think, I would put on maybe the table here, we're going to have to really look at how we can make those voices heard, because in some cases, they're using us as their complaint system. I think that's something which, as a committee, I want to make sure we get right, that voice is actually heard in our final piece of work.
Marie.
What you were saying, Neil, I think some of the people that I spoke to said that about the level of stress, mm-hmm. and they said that when people are under stress to make cuts, what they do is revert to maybe not very effective managerial styles. Yeah. Yeah. So whilst they all had very positive things to say about, for example, the patient safety programme and how, you know, excellent that was at empowering people on the co-face and delivering bottom-up change, he said when people are under pressure, they just revert to top down. Mm-hmm. This is what you're going to do in bullying.
Yeah, I think that was definitely the came across. Any other issues people want to raise? If people took note, I took screens of notes, so pass them on to the committee clerks. But if there's others, please send them on so that we capture some of these themes that came forward. Okay. As agreed at the previous meeting, we'll now move into private session.